Amen. Well, you don't know what else to say, just say amen.
Amen.
Well, that's good. Amen.
Amen.
I just preach a whole service. Amen. 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 And all the amens. Amen.
Amen.
I'm going to try this morning just to kind of present a few things to you that I think is very important for us to understand as Christians. And one of the things I think we understand as a Christian is I believe that we all have a vision, all have a hope, all have a dream. Now, I know over the years, because of different circumstances, our vision has kind of taken different courses. I believe a lot of our callings are irrevocable. I believe God's got a calling in our life, and He's going to get that done, whatever it takes to get it done. Amen?
Amen.
But I believe that if we're not careful, we will miss out on God's vision to fulfill our life. I believe that we have a vision. God has a vision for us to fulfill what He's called us to do. Now, I will tell you that without a doubt that I believe that, and I'm going to say this, and I'm going to say it, and I'm going to stop, and I'm going to pause, because I think it's going to need to soak in for a second, but I believe that real life begin at Christianity, at salvation.
Amen?
Amen? I believe our real life began when we got saved.
Amen.
I think we existed, I think we got by, but I think when we accepted Christ into our life, that's when our life began. Because that's when we got everything online with God, and God says, okay, now that He's mine, I'm going to use Him, and I'm going to put Him in the direction He should go.
Amen.
Many times we got off course over the years. I know myself, I've got off course over the years, and God's got to kind of slap us upside the head and get us back on course.
Yeah,
and anybody's been slapped upside the head by God, you know what I'm talking about.
Amen.
It's not fun.
Amen.
But it's thankful because God chastises and corrects those that He loves.
Amen.
So when He does, we know that He loves us, right? Now, over the Scripture, throughout the Scripture, there's many people that's had vision, and there's many people that's had revelation, and many people have dreams, and different ones for different reasons. I want to highlight a couple of them, and I'm going to talk about vision for just a minute. One of the persons I want to talk about real quick is David. We know David to be King David, as Caleb was talking about today, did a lot of radical things. He wrote the book of Psalms, all these things. But King David had a vision that meant his son was going to fulfill the bill of the temple. Now listen to me. This is interesting because, you see, he knew that he wasn't going to be around to fulfill the bill of the temple. So he began to get all the materials together, get everything that was needed so King Solomon could complete the task of the temple. So many times I think we need to have, as a builder, we need to have this master mentality, builder mentality resource. Now, what do you mean by that? A master's builder's mentality is someone sometimes is going to build something that's never been built, use technology that's never has been used before, and begin to disciple somebody or raise somebody up to complete the task, knowing that without a doubt, they're not going to see the complete of the task.
Amen?
Amen? So that's what we find here with King David. King David raised Solomon. He began to collect all the gold. He began to collect all the silver. He began to collect all the lumber. He began to collect everything he needed so Solomon complete the task that David's vision started, right? Okay. Another person we look at, Naomi. Naomi, if you look at her word, her name means bitter. She was a bitter old woman, but she had a vision. And her vision was to raise Ruth because Ruth was her daughter-in-law, and her son died, and she had a vision for Ruth to remarry. Okay? All through the Scripture, you find different people. Esther. Esther was a Jew that was called to the kingdom because the king killed his wife because she disobeyed. Now, sometimes we need to bring that back. No, I'm just kidding. Just joking. Just joking. Let me think of it. No, I was joking. Amen? But we find a king that because the wife did something wrong, he disposed of her, and so he was looking for another queen. And to be a queen during that time, they had to go into a place of a purity. So they went to a place where they stayed for a period of time to make sure she wasn't pregnant, make sure she had no diseases. There was a time of purification. And Esther knew that she had a vision for her people. And so she began to say, you know what, to be queen, I realize all the other ladies, when they called all the ladies and said, listen, what kind of clothes you want? What kind of perfume you want? They took them to the mall. Come on, somebody. They went to the mall and they said, I like to shop at this store. I want these things. I like this clothes. But Esther knew that if she was going to get to the king, the vision she had to be fulfilled, she said, I want what the king wants. Come on, somebody. And so she called the king's servant and said, hey, what does the king like? Well, the king likes this color, likes this perfume, likes this. So Esther says, that's what I want. She had a vision. You see, she had a vision and hope for something to be fulfilled. Another person we see all through the Scripture, Joseph, we talked about Joseph last week. Joseph had a vision and a dream, but he spoke a little too soon. Amen? But guess what? Even during that time of stupidity in his life, God fulfilled his vision. Amen? Sometimes we can be stupid and step out of the vision that God has for us, but God's going to get what he wants done. You believe that? I believe that. Amen? Now, I was thinking about all these visions and all these things, and I had to bring something personal to it in my own personal life, and I'm going to spend a few seconds talking about that for myself. And when I surrendered to the ministry, I knew that God had a calling in my life for a long time, and I ran from it. I ran from the calling. But when I finally surrendered, I sold everything that wasn't tied down. I felt like the Beverly Hillbillies. I loaded up the wagon, and we moved to Dallas. Amen. And so we go to Dallas, we get to Dallas, and as we're there, I begin to really build my prayer life during this time. And one of the things I would do was I would go out early in the morning before my day began, and I would walk the track. There, he had a huge track by the compass we lived at, by the house we lived at, and I would walk the track, and during that time of walking the track, I would pray for God's direction and vision. And at that time, I knew that I was going to go to Russia. And so my prayers went something like this. God, give me vision for Russia. God, give me directions for Russia. God, give me a vision for the people of Russia. God, give me a vision for Russia. And literally, while I'm praying that, the Spirit of the Lord did one of those moments in my life where he slapped me upside the head, and this is what he spoke to my heart. He says, how in the world can you pray for a vision of that large, of that size, when you don't have a vision for your sons? Come on, somebody. I'm going to tell you what I did, and I'm saying this today because I, you know, I'm not here to embarrass any of my sons, but if I have an opportunity to do so, I will. But this is not that moment. But for that moment of time, I began to pray, God, give me a vision for all three of my sons, and I sat down. I'm speaking to somebody today, okay? I'm speaking to the hearts, and let me just share this with you. Maybe you're a female, and you're the spiritual leader in your house. Guess what? You need to pray a vision for your children. Amen. Because if you don't have a vision for your kids, the world will give them one. The world will direct them. The world will tell them where to go. But I began to pray for my kids, my sons, and as I did that, I sat down with a piece of paper and pencil, and I wrote down what I felt like God was really speaking to me about my boys. I had a moment in my home where I invited them into my bedroom. My wife and I went into the room together with all my sons. I anointed their heads with oil. I read the vision over their life at that moment, and over the next years, until they were grown men, I spoke that vision. Every opportunity I had to tell them about their vision, I gave them their vision. And to this day, I see them fulfilling and walking in their vision. Can I give God an amen? Amen? I'm telling you this morning that we have a vision that God is birthing inside of us, and we need to learn how to speak it. Amen? Now, the Bible talks about vision, and David speaks to his son, King Solomon, and Solomon says this. He says, where there is no vision, the people perish. It goes on to say, well, children are left alone. They bring shame to their mother. All these things he talks about, where there is no vision, people perish. Where there is no vision and direction, people die. Because people need to be told where to go. Come on, somebody. One of the visions we have here in this church is taking temporary families and bringing them to a permanent place. One of the visions we have here is when people come from Fort Polk. We've been here 18 years. Listen, I get calls all the time. I got a call this last week where this young man calls me on the phone and he says, Pastor, do you remember me? And my mind was racing, and I'm trying to race and remember who he was, but he began to tell me different things to try to bring back my memory. But what he said to me was this. He said, I want you to know I was there in 2003 and 2004. He said, my life has not been the same. My wife and I are doing great things for the kingdom. Our kids are being raised in godly manner. And God is good. And I'm thinking to myself, that's our vision. Amen. Taking people from a temporary time they're here and bringing them to a permanent place where no matter where they go or no matter what they do, they remember what God done for them here. Amen. That's the vision of the church. That's the hope that we have for people in this place. Without a vision, the people perish. Habakkuk said this. He says, if you have a vision, you need to write it down. It says, write it down, make it clear so the people who read it can run with it. Amen. See, sometimes we're not clear with our vision. And I'm probably horrible about many times about some direction I'm trying to go. I'm not real clear with it. But you know what? I'm learning. I'm learning that when I get clear with it, other people can get it. Because you know, sometimes we know it so well. Hey, come on. You ever know something so well that you just figure everybody else should know it too? Yeah, You know what's really funny about that? I was thinking about telling somebody this week that we're talking about, why didn't you just build where you were at and your location? I said, you know, one of the strangest things is I know that location over there, and I've been traveling to that location over there for the last 18 years. I know exactly where it is, no problem finding it, but there's people all over this parish don't know where we're located.
Yeah, come on now.
Right.
Yeah,
that funny?
Yeah,
come on. I know it's here. I come here all the time. But there's people in this parish who I say, I pastor Christian Living Fellowship, and they go, where's that? But you know what's really funny? Now that we have it clear on the highway, people go, I see where you're at.
Yeah,
you see what I'm saying? I mean, it's amazing how the difference when we're clear about what our direction is and are clear. God told us, you know, be in a place where we can trip over hope. People are looking for hope. We want to be in a place to trip over hope, and that's where we're located.
Amen.
Why? Because we want to be clear about what we're doing for the kingdom of God. There's nothing hidden. No agenda's hidden. God wants a clear vision for us. Now, I'm going to lay out a couple of things that I think that you need to see to understand the difference between a godly vision and a worldly vision. Okay? Now here's the first thing is this. A godly vision, always without a doubt, leads you to victory.
Amen.
Godly vision, he will not bring you to a place where not we won't be victorious. When we follow God's vision, God always brings us to a place where we will be victorious. Oh, sting, oh, death, where's your sting? Come on, somebody. The Bible says in Corinthians, let me read that to you. Oh, death, where's your sting? Oh, hell, where's your victory? The sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is the law. But thanks be to God who gives us the victory. How? Through our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, my beloved brethren, be steadfast and immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing that your labor, knowing that your vision is not in vain in the Lord. God will give us victory. Anytime there's a direction that we're going in, if we know it's God, he always brings us to a victorious place. God will not drop you off in a place where you won't be victorious. I believe that with all my heart. God don't want us to go. God is not going to give us something we can't handle. And whatever he does, he's going to give us a way of escape in all those areas of our life. Also, here's the next thing. We're talking about the difference between worldly vision and godly vision. Godly vision will always, without a doubt, you will walk in integrity. You will not have to lie. You will not have to cheat. You will not have to steal to build. Come on, somebody. God's vision for us is going to walk in integrity. If somebody says, well, I've got to do this little thing here to be able to do this, and it's not godly, I'm telling you, that's not God's way.
Amen.
It's not God's way. Listen, I remember when we were praying for this property, and God spoke to my heart about it and said, for whatever reason, the Tilly family has some land on Highway 171. You need to talk to them about it. The next day, I see Rodney Tilly. I said, Mr. Tilly, I said, do y'all have land on Highway 171? He looked at me kind of strange. And he said, man, it's funny you said that. He said, my mama's 83 years old. Just the other day, she said, we need to get rid of our land on the main highway. I said, really? I said, where's it at? He began to tell me. You couldn't even see it because it was so grown up over there. And I said, well, how much is there? He says, I don't even know, maybe a couple acres. I said, really? I said, I'd like to talk to your mom about it. He said to me, I would, but there's two other businessmen ahead of you. Before you ever talk to her about it, she's already promised two other guys that she would give them the first options before she sold it to anybody else. I said, okay. She told me who they were. They passed by the next day. I knew one of the guys. I called him on the phone, and I said, hey. I called him by name, and I said, I understand you got the first option to buy this piece of property. He said, I do, Pastor, but he says, I understand you're interested in it. And I didn't talk to the church about it at this time. But he knew because of Rodney telling him that. But all of a sudden, he says, you know what, Pastor? So I believe the next guy behind you is going to buy it. He said, how about if I buy it and sell it to you? Now, to me, that kind of felt a little wrong. Come on, somebody. Guess what? I said to him, I said, you know what? If it's God, we'll walk in integrity and we'll get it.
Yeah.
And he says, you know what? Then I'm out of the way. The next guy's up. The next day, I see the other guy. I'm in town, I see him, I speak to him, and I said, you got a moment? He said, sure, Pastor. I said, can you come outside for a second? He walks outside with me. I said, I understand you got the second option at buying this piece of property. He says, I do, Pastor, but I heard you were interested in it. I'm like, who else knows, amen? At that time, you know. And so I said to him, I said, I am. He said, I'll tell you what, Pastor. He says, we don't know how much is there. We don't know how much you want. You go for it. If you don't buy it, I will buy it. Guess what? I went and sat down with her. Long story short, she made it so affordable to us to buy. Literally, I hate to use this term because it sounds so bad, but we literally stole property on 171. Guess what? Walking in integrity always leads us to victory.
Amen.
When we do the right thing, God always leads us in the right way. Here's the third thing about vision is this. Understanding the difference between godly vision and worldly vision. Godly vision will always lead you to salvation. Did you hear what I just said? Godly vision always leads us to salvation. If somebody comes to me and says, there's a revival going across over here and people are flocking to it, and there's a revival, and I'm asking the question, well, are people getting saved? Well, no, it's just a revival. People are getting their feel good over, and nobody's getting saved. I'm going, that's not God. Listen to me. I'm telling you, anytime God's in the middle of it, people are getting saved. God's vision always leads to salvation. Now, they're telling me, listen, you come there, people are getting saved by the groves. I'm going, I want to see what's going on. Why? Because God's vision always leads to salvation. Because God's job for us to have vision and purpose is so other people can find salvation. Amen. See, what happens is the enemy don't like the fact when you begin to fulfill your vision and your purpose in your life. Because when you begin to fulfill that purpose and vision in your life, people around you are going to get saved. Amen. Why? Because that's the direction you're going to teach them to go. That's the direction that God always leads us to go. Now, here's the part here I want to just travel to just for a moment. But when we talk about vision and why we have vision as a believer, and I said earlier how life began at salvation is simply this. Jesus bought us with a price. We're not our own. Did you hear what I said? We don't belong to ourselves. We belong to Christ. He bought us with a price we could not pay. He paid a price he did not owe. Amen? He bought us with a price. This is what he says in the book of Corinthians. I think it's Corinthians here. Let me look that up real quick. My pages are crooked today. Here it is. 1 Corinthians 6:19. This is what he says. Do you not know that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit who is in you, whom you have from God, and you're not your own? That's what he says, you're not your own. For you were bought at a price. Therefore, glorify God in the body and your spirit, which is our God's. We're bought at a price because we belong to him. So our vision is his vision, right? Keep going. 7:19, it says this. Let each one remain in the same calling, vision, hope, dream, in which he was called. Were you called while a slave, do you not consider, do not be could not do not be concerned about it, but if you can be made free, rather use it. For he who is called in the Lord while a slave is the Lord's free man. Likewise, he who is called while free is Christ's slave. Verse 23, you were bought at a price. Do not become slaves of men. Brethren, let each one remain with God in the state in which he was called. Did you hear that? Okay. So we understand that we bought with a price. Now, I preached a message about this a long time ago, and I'm not going to develop this, but I'm going to ask you the simple question, and this is the question that I want to propose to you today, and this is really what I want you to examine your hearts about today. When God bought you, what did he get? Did he get a lemon? Come on, somebody. See, we understand the terminology when I say you got a lemon. A lemon is like a car that the manufacturer designed to work a certain way, to perform a certain way, and a lemon is when that car don't perform the way the manufacturer designed it to perform. You hear what I'm saying? See, there's different things, whether it be an appliance, whether it be a washing machine, whether it be all kind of things that the manufacturer, the wholesale, whatever, they designed it to work a certain way. And when it don't perform and do exactly what it's called to do, we call that a lemon, right? Again, I propose the question to you this morning. When God bought you, did he get a lemon? Okay? Now, what I want to do this morning is I want to just highlight a few things that will help you. And I know this is going to sound kind of strange, but I want to help you from being a lemon. Amen? Because a lemon by itself is just a bitter thing, right? Here's the first thing is this. The first thing we must understand about not being a lemon is we have to learn to listen. If we're going to be working and designed and creative and doing what the manufacturer called us to do, we have to learn to listen. Because if we don't listen, we can't hear. Amen? Amen. Now, learn to listen, that sounds like a real vague thing to do. But you know what? Sometimes you have to learn to listen. You got to listen on purpose. Because I know, and my wife will tell you, you know, there have been times in our marriage where, especially when I was working a lot of hours and I was talking to a lot of people, and the conversation she had during the day with the kids was, "Mommy, I want a cookie," you know. So intellectually, when you got home, she wanted to talk to you. And even as a guy, you only have so many words a day that you use. When a woman has a little bit more words in her vocabulary for that day to use. So she gets home and she wants to talk to you, and you look at her and you nod like you're listening, and you're thinking about the ball game, or you're thinking about what she's cooking for supper, or you're thinking about other things. So sometimes you got to learn to listen. Okay? Now, there was a guy by the name of Solomon. Now, Solomon, in my opinion, was one of the greatest prophets of all time. Now, Jesus talks about John the Baptist being the greatest prophet. Solomon, to me, was a great prophet for the Old Testament. Because Solomon's mama, when she was pregnant for Solomon, she said, "Listen, I'm going to give my son," just as we dedicated this baby this morning, she said, "I'm going to give my son to you, God." And the way she did that was, she said, "At my son at an early age, I'm going to allow him to go work for the priests." So Solomon worked for Eli. Now, Eli, at this time, was a priest who was not really doing the right thing. His sons weren't doing the right things, and things were not going on right. But Eli was the priest. So Solomon was just a young boy. He's sleeping, and all of a sudden he hears, "Solomon, Solomon." He wakes up. He runs into Eli's room and says, "Yes, Eli, did you call me?" And Eli's like, "Dude, I'm asleep. I didn't say anything. Go back to bed." Okay? Again, he hears, "Solomon, Solomon." He gets up. He runs in there. And again, Eli says, "You know what? I didn't say anything, Solomon. Go back to bed. It's late. It's in the middle of the night. I didn't call you." So he goes back in. This happens like two or three times. To finally, Eli, who was supposed to be Solomon's mentor and teaching him, realizes that God was trying to speak to him. So he says to him, "Listen, when you hear your name called again, say, 'Here I am, Lord. Here's your servant, Lord.'" And guess what? He did that. So next time God says, "Solomon, Solomon," he said, "Here I am, Lord." And the Bible talks about he learned to listen. And after that, Solomon become mighty. Now listen, he's the one who anointed King Solomon whenever. Did I say Saul? No, King Saul. He anointed Saul. And all of a sudden, he also was the same one that anointed David. King Solomon was a great prophet. Amen? Why? Because he learned to listen. There's times in our life where God's going, "Hey, you," and we think it's something else. Come on, somebody. The Bible says that we know His voice. You see, the sheep know His voice. Now, I'm telling you today, to know His voice, you got to know what He sounds like. You got to know what His word is. Come on. And I believe you can know what God's speaking to us. And we should know the difference between God and the world speaking to us. So God wants us to be directed in the way He wants us to hear His voice. And so, if we're going to keep from being a lemon, we've got to listen to what God is saying to keep from being that lemon. Amen? Amen. Here's the next thing. We won't become a lemon. And this is one, again, I probably used before, but I want to really highlight it. We won't become a lemon if we keep a spirit of excellence. Now, what is a spirit of excellence? A spirit of excellence we find in the book of Daniel, where Daniel found favor with the king because he had a spirit of excellence, right? Now, a spirit of excellence, well, listen to me, church, because it's important you hear this. A spirit of excellence is doing the best you can on where you got, on what you have, okay? Now, why did you say that, Pastor? Because too many times I hear people say, "Oh, I didn't want to come to Fort Polk. I don't belong at Fort Polk." Guess what? You'll never find your vision. You'll become a lemon in the kingdom of God because you're not walking out a spirit of excellence. Here's a spirit of excellence for you today. You ready? Do the best you can on where God plants you. And wherever that may be, you will be one miserable person if you're constantly looking for that rainbow in the sky. I worked with people before that all these they would say was, "I'm here until something better comes along." Can I tell you that's a miserable person to work with? Because every day they come there, they want to be somewhere else.
Yeah, come on now.
Amen? Yeah. Having a spirit of excellence is doing the best you can on where you at, on what you got. Listen, learn to say, "God, wherever you plant me, I'm going to give you my best." If you learn to give God your best, and guess what? You will not be a lemon. Because God's going, "You know what? I can use somebody who's going to say, 'You know what? I'm going to do my best wherever I got or wherever I'm planted.'" Amen? Learn to give God your best. Here's the next thing. Is this right here. We stop becoming a lemon when we stop that me, 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 me attitude. Come on. Too many times, if we're not careful, we go through life with just everything's about me. Me, 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 me. Why me? Me, 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 me. Everything's about me. You know what I'm talking about? I said early on is that lemon by itself is bitter, is it not? Amen? Amen? But you mix it with a little water and a little sugar, you got some refreshing going on. Amen? So sometimes you got to walk in unity. The Bible talks a lot about unity. Instead of being about me, 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 you got to learn what the Bible says. The Bible says, when two or more gather in my name, there I am. The Bible says, one can put 1,000, two can what? Put 10,000 to flight. All through the scripture, Christ don't want you to walk around me, 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 me. Can I tell you that you cannot be a me and be a church? Did I say that out loud? You can't be a me and be a church. Because the only way you're a church is you got to walk in unity. Amen. You got to be in unity to be a church. You can't walk around going, oh, it's all about me. To avoid being a me, you got to be in unity. Amen. What, is Mike in here? Mike, what did you tell me earlier today? I'm trying to remember you said something about that me. There you go. A Mimi is a pacifier. Just stick a pacifier in your mouth. Amen? Now, you know what? I said this before. It's okay to give a baby a bottle, but when that baby's got a big old hairy mustache, you stick a bottle in his mouth, it's ugly. Amen? Some of us need to grow up. Quit being a me, 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 and say, God, you know what? I don't need a pacifier. Give me some T-bone steak. That makes me hungry. Amen? Here's the next thing is this. We're talking about not being that lemon. We won't become that lemon when we take those things God give us, those God-given opportunities. Let me read this to you, okay? Galatians says this, do not be deceived. God is not mocked. For whatever man sows, he also he'll reap. For he who sows to the flesh will the flesh reap corruption, but he who sows to the Spirit will the Spirit reap everlasting life. Let us not grow weary while doing good, for in due season we shall reap if we do not lose heart. Therefore, as we have opportunity, let us do good to all, especially to those who are in the household of faith. Now let's jump back again. Therefore, as we have opportunity, I believe today that we will not be that lemon if we take those God-given opportunities he gives us and utilize them. Amen? We're all given opportunity. What we do with it is another thing. When somebody comes to me and says, well, you know what? They're more successful than me. You know what? Most of the time, they were given the same opportunity you were given. Amen? But they utilized it. They took their opportunity. Now, I know what I'm about to say, many of you have already heard this before, but I think it really brings this point across. There was a story about a guy in South Louisiana, and a storm had came, and the floods were coming, and he's on his porch, and a big old four-wheel drive truck pulls up and says, hey, dude, get in, man, the floods are coming. And he simply says, God will take care of me. Well, guess what? The floods rise a little higher. By now, the truck can't get there, so God sends The guy shows up in a boat, and he says, hey, man, get in my boat. The flood's coming. The guy's like, God's going to take care of me. By now, the flood's coming. The guy's on top of the roof. He cannot swim. All of a sudden, God sends a helicopter, and the guy says, get in the helicopter. He's going to like, don't worry about me. God's going to take care of me. And the guy drowns. He gets to heaven, and he's like, God, I thought you said you're going to take care of me. He says, I tried. I sent a truck, I sent a boat, and I sent a helicopter. See, the point is, he didn't use the opportunity God gave him, and he drowned. Too many times we go through life, and God's given us golden opportunities. Whatever they are, utilize the opportunities God's given us. Don't you know how to utilize God's opportunity? Amen? See, if we don't utilize God's given opportunities, then we go around miserable. I tell this story because I mean it. You know, when God called me to pastor a church, and I started preaching, I struggled because I felt like I couldn't pronounce a lot of the words, and I still can't. But you know what? Finally, one day, I woke up and realized God said, who made your mouth? And so I began to realize that, you know what, God, you give me the opportunity to preach, then I'm going to do whatever you call me to do. And I realized at that moment, my life began to change. Now, did I pronounce words different? No, I still say things wrong. You know, the biggest word I know is mayonnaise, amen? And I cut it short and say mayo, But the point is, take the opportunity God gives you. We're all given opportunity, are we not? We all have golden opportunities that God is trying to say, listen, here's your opportunity to do something. Use it, and when you use it, begin to benefit the people around you. Because he even says, those opportunities you use in the household of faith. What does that mean? The people around you in church. Those opportunities God gives you to bless them, bless them. Why? Because people come, they're usually struggling, they walk in this place, they're beat up, they've been, you know, tattered from the week and shot down for the week, and God gives you, say, you know what, take an opportunity to tell that person that that's a pretty dress they got on. I know that sounds silly, but you'd be surprised how might a kind word, you know, like, well, that's really a nice outfit you got on. You think so? Might lighten their day. Now, I know that sounds weird, but guess what? You're human, and people want to hear nice things. Whatever opportunity God gives you to do something nice, take advantage of it. And when you're doing those things, I promise you, you won't be developed as a lemon. You'll do what God called you to do. Here's the last one. Is this one right here. Simply this. To avoid from being a lemon, never, never neglect the God-given gift. God has given us all gifts. Don't neglect what he's given you. Timothy says this. He's talking about the ministry here. Let no one despise your youth. Be an example to the believer in word, in conduct, in love, in spirit, in faith, in purity. Till I come, give attention to reading, to exaltation, to doctrine. Do not neglect the gift that is in you, which were given to you by the prophecy with the laying on the hands of the eldership. Meditate on these things. Give yourself entirely to them, that your progress may be evident to all. Take heed to yourself and to the doctrine. Continue in them, for in doing this... Now, what are we talking about here? We're talking about not neglecting the gift. In doing this, he says, you will save both yourself and those who hear you. Amen. Don't neglect what God's given you. The last part he says there in Timothy is this. Timothy, he says, I thank God whom I'm served with a pure conscience, as my forefathers did. As without ceasing, I remember you in my prayers night and day, greatly desiring to see you, being mindful of your tears, that I may be filled with joy. When I call to remembrance the genuine faith that is in you, which dwelt first in your grandmother Lois and your mother Eunice. Now, I love this because it begins to talk about the opportunities and things, the gifts that were given to the mom and the grandmother. She passed on.
Amen.
Amen? We could pass on these things. He says, Therefore, I remind you to stir up the gift of God, which is in you through the laying on of hands. For God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of power and love and a sound mind. Do not neglect God's gift that he gave you. Everyone in this room has a special gift. Do they not?
Amen.
They do. And things that I can't do. I can do things you can't do, and you can do things I can't do. Amen?
Amen.
Do not neglect what God's given you. When you got a special thing that God's given you, use it. Use it. You know, if we're not careful, we belittle ourselves to the point that we never fulfill none of the vision and hope that God has for us. And I'm not here to give you some guru message that, oh, you got to be, you know, mom or whatever this, you know, I'm talking about. I'm talking about believing in the gifts that God gave you. Because when you begin to believe that God chose you and called you and designed you and created you to do certain things, then believe he can.
Amen.
Amen?
Amen?
I mean, my God, Thomas Weidman. Thomas and I have been friends for a long time. He has a gift with computers. I do not have a clue what he does. You guess what? When he starts telling me something, you know what I say? Thomas, just cut it short. Tell me what I need to do. Because you can explain to me all day long, well, the gadget, gadget, go to get him about it. I'm like, that's not my gift. Tell me what. And he's like, shut up and plug it in. Okay, I get that part. Amen? Because there's gifts and stuff that he has that I don't have. And there's people in this room that has gifts and callings in your life that if you're not careful, brother, you will die with them.
Yeah, come on now.
You will die with them. You know why? Now listen to me, parents. Listen to me, mamas and dads. Never, ever tell your kids they're ugly or bad or dumb or stupid or they can't do anything. Don't do that, because you're stealing that gift that God gave them.
Amen.
Because if you're not careful, man, you might say something in a silly way and ruin their life. You got to learn that they're little baby gifts, just like that your gift is just a bigger gift developed, hopefully it's developed.
Amen.
Don't neglect the gift God's called you that he's called you with. Amen? We all have a hope and a vision, and this morning, you know, my hope and my vision for you today is that you leave this place realizing that if there's anything that's causing you to be that lemon, that you change.
Amen.
That you change it. You just change it. And here's the thing that I want to promise you. It's never too late.
Amen.
It's never, ever too late. If someone tells you it was too late for something, just look at them and say, you liar. It's never too late. Because in God's kingdom, brother, it's never too late. My wife, who you know I adore, my Lord, after we went through all that we went through with the kidney transplant, she came to me and said, I'm going to medical school. She got enrolled in school, started going through the process, get hours away from pre-med, and changed her major and went to be a teacher. Now, she was 46 when she went back to school. 46. You tell me, well, I'm 21, 22, I can't go back to school. Are you kidding me? At 46, you're not thinking about school. You're not really in the norm. But guess what? I admire the fact that she did. She went back and she got her degree, and now she teaches science at the junior high. Guess what? It's never too late. It's never too late for you. I didn't go to seminary until I was 34. Trish did the same thing. Many of y'all, guess what? It's never too late. God's got a gift in your heart. Let him develop it. And if somebody comes to you and says otherwise, kick him in the shin. Amen? See, being charismatic, you can shoot him and raise him from the dead later. Amen? Just kidding. Test 1, 2. Kidding. Just joking. Not really. God is good. Amen? Father, we thank you so much that you have created us for such a day as this. You designed us. You developed us. And God, whatever your call is for each individual in this life, whatever the vision, whatever the hope you have for us, God, let us fulfill it. God, let us become and do what you called us to do. Heads bowed, eyes closed. Maybe you're here this morning, and maybe you might say, Pastor, I realized today when you were talking about not being a lemon, there were some things you mentioned that I need to work on. Now, I don't know what it is. I'm not going to go through all of them, but I do know that I want to pray for you. I want to mix my faith with your faith. So if you're here this morning and one of those areas kind of ministers to you and that's an area that you need prayer in, I want to mix my faith with your faith. Heads bowed, eyes closed, not here to embarrass you or call you out, just here to pray with you. If that's you this morning, right where you're at, just pray for me, Pastor. Raise your hand and put it back down. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Lord. Anyone else, just raise your hand and put it back down. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Lord. I see those hands. I see those hands. Father, I thank you so much that you love this so much. God, hands come up all over this room. God, I mix my faith with their faith. And God, whatever you speak into their hearts to do, God, let them fulfill it. Let them take the opportunity. Let them fulfill the calling that you have for them in their life. God, I thank you for your vision and your hope, your purpose, your love, your mercy, your kindness. Be with them in a supernatural way. Heads bowed, eyes closed. Maybe you're here this morning and you might say, Pastor, I don't know Jesus. I've never asked him to come into my heart, my life. Or you might be here today and you might say, Pastor, I realize this morning that I'm backslidden. Well, let's get that right today. Right where you're at, just pray this prayer from the heart. Just begin to say, Jesus, forgive me of my sins. Jesus, come into my heart. Jesus, I ask you to save me. I ask you to forgive me. I ask you I want to make you Lord and Savior of my home, my life. I repent. If you prayed that prayer this morning for the first time, or maybe a prayer of rededication, again, I'm not going to embarrass you. I just want to pray for you. If you prayed that prayer, just raise your hand and put it back down. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Lord. Anyone else? Thank you, Jesus. God, I thank you for your salvation. God, thank you for saving us. Thank you for delivering us. Thank you for keeping us. Now, God, I pray blessings on every man, woman, and child in this place. God, watch over us, guide us, and be with us as we honor you with everything we do. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. If you receive that word, let's give God a hand. Amen.